Before I give brief introductions to each of them, I also would encourage those in the audience that are wiser than me and say, no, that's not how it is. Like Nadia, really to speak out. I mean, because like I said earlier, I know this audience and I know the depth of knowledge and expertise that lies there. So I'm going to start to my far left. I'm just going to introduce you. Daniel Banks is a performer, lives in Santa Fe, New Mexico, is involved in DNAWORKS, which is like, he sent me an email. They said, I'm not a nonprofit, I'm an LLC. And I said, fine, even better, let's just figure out how we do it. He's involved in engagement projects as well, and is pretty committed to working with you. Next to Daniel is Denise Yohara, who we'll see a little bit of her work later today. Performance artist, the grants manager at the Tucson Pima Arts Council, and a bit of a troublemaker in a sweet way. And next year is Kimmy Azal, who's a dancer who's been working in Tucson an awful lot, deals an awful lot with environmental issues, land use issues, and now has residency at the National Park Service, where she's working on a project called Stand With Us Saguaro. Is that the title or cat is
it? Yeah,
Stand With Us Saguaro. So, you know, because Tucson is bordered by the east and west by the Saguaro National Park. So our basin is smaller in comparison to Tucson. So in some ways, the city is sort of contained. So Daniel, I want to just let you start off. Come on, I know you well enough, but I know that you're really good at improvisation. So ultimately, we were just asked to sort of, the leading question was really talk a little about the support system that you understand and you see for individual artists, and also give a little like commentary about what you think the aesthetic vocabularies that are unique to where you work.
Thank you, Roberto. I'm gonna actually ask if I can defer, since DNAWORKS is very new to the Southwest region, and so it's with great humility that I feel I'm sitting up here, and I'd like to defer to someone who's been working in this region longer first, and have that voice be the first voice, if someone will agree to do that.
Sure.
Okay, my name is Kimmy, and I think one thing I wanted to do just before diving into that question is just piggyback on the idea of the we, and just think for a minute about some of the other we in this region, and one of those other we's is the saguaro cactus, and the other one is El Jefe, who is a lone male jaguar who's roaming southern Arizona, who's come up from Mexico and lives in this region. And so I just want to mention those species because I think they're very much a part of the we, and the beautiful thing about them is that they defy language and they defy borders and they defy funding. And I think we have a lot to learn from those species as part of our we, and there's a million other desert species that we can learn from. So I just wanted to say that. And then the question is, say the question again.
Well, there's sort of two prongs. The notion of sort of the aesthetic vocabularies that you think come out of this locale, and then the support system for your work as an artist.
Okay, so moving from thinking about those other species as species that belong in the desert and also as metaphors, I think that some of the desert aesthetic that I think about in my work, and I am a multidisciplinary artist, I'm a writer, a choreographer, and a visual artist. Most of my engagement work comes in the form of performance, and I've looked at water issues in the desert, endangered species, food security, through participatory projects. I used to run a small modern dance company and no longer do because I got exhausted with doing that. And so sort of took the leap to become a more of an individual free agent. I'll be partnering happily with Borderlands Theater this season with a project that is funded by the National Endowment for the Arts as part of their Imagine Your Parks project, which is a partnership with the National Park Service. So really looking at sort of the cultural and natural history of our region, particularly around the saguaro cactus, and what does it mean to duet with that cactus as a mover, as a culture bearer, as a scientist? What are all the relationships we have with that cactus? So when I think about the arts landscape in Tucson, I think a lot about that desert aesthetic of resiliency, the way that our species here work really hard for water. It sometimes feels like we're just walking and walking and walking for days and days and days in the desert, and we just hope that there's an oasis. And oftentimes there are, whether it's in the form of a really cool partnership that affords new funding and new audiences, or new collaborators that sort of expand the audience or expand the way of thinking. So, the hard thing about that is that you're sort of walking on faith, which I think the desert is all about anyway. But whether or not there's an oasis, like, we all just keep walking, and then it's like, oh, well, we walked this far already, we must have seen a fucking show because, we're this far. But I see that a lot, with my like amazing colleagues that are in the room, that there's this resilience, and I think also a kind of spirit of resistance too, because we're a poor city in a poor state, in a desert. There is this sort of like hovering idea of scarcity, and yet there's this resistance. Again, I think of the saguaro and El Jefe de Jaguar. They resist border militarization. This jaguar is like crossed the border despite, all the things that are trying to stop everything from crossing the border. So I think as artists we have that same kind of resistance, whether we're working on, human justice issues, environmental justice issues. And I think that there's this writer, John Van Dyke, who wrote a famous book about the desert in the 1920s. He crossed the Chihuahuan Desert and the Sonoran Desert, and he characterized this place as, it's like all beak and thorn and talon, and the desert is at war with itself. And you can really look at this place in that way. And then also, if you hang out a little bit longer, you also begin to see the ways in which desert plants adapt and work with each other. And I think that is also what I see as a result of that scarcity, is that spirit of collaboration, which is really beautiful and welcome.
So I'm Denise Uehara. I'm a performance artist and interdisciplinary artist. The project that you'll be seeing a little showing of later this afternoon is called Shooting Columbus. We are the Shooting Columbus Collective, so we work as a collective. And the members of that collective are Cui Benali, who's from Flagstaff, who's an activist and musician, Ryan Pinto, who is a b-boy dancer and traditional Omaha grass dancer, and they are also Diné, and Ryan is Diné and Hopi, Diné meaning Navajo. And Rachel Bodich, who's here in the audience with us tonight, and Adam Cooper-Tehran, who is Yaqui and Chicano, and myself, I'm Okinawan and Japanese American. So the majority of our lead artists in this group are indigenous. Rachel and I are not Native American. I'm indigenous on the Okinawan side of the family. We have been very interested in a very long-term project, which has a parallel track with community, but we are also respectful of ourselves as artists and that we have a certain vision that we want to accomplish in our work. So we've been working, it's about a four-year project. We're about at a halfway mark right now. We will be premiering it in Tucson in 2017. The premise is, if indigenous scientists built a time machine and went back to 1492 and shot Columbus, how would your life today be different? So, if you go back and you shoot Columbus, it may splinter off into multiple universes. What we're asking the audience to do is to walk into a room which has multiple universes, multiple voices, multiple points of view, sometimes even conflicting points of view, and that's all right. That is allowed in this new universe. We want to create a space of imagination. So here we are in the Southwest, and we have, there are, you know, many, many issues that the indigenous communities are facing, including land appropriation, that they have to push off their land, taking of the land and the resources or sources from the earth. The list is very, very long. Part of it is that by creating these multiple universes, we also have a space for these different voices to exist. And also as we begin to tour, which we hope to do, that as we go to different communities where there are indigenous voices, they can be part of those multiple universes as well. We're in the research phase, which is funded by the Network Ensemble Theaters and through a travel and exchange grant, and also by at ASU and the Herbert Institute. The production itself is funded by the MAP Fund. We're very, very helpful for this, thankful for this support. It's made a big difference in our ability to work together in a professional manner. We also wanted to thank the ACA and NEFA for just their support and just being there as we develop this work. So in terms of resources locally, they are small, but we decided it really pushed us to move beyond local. I also happen to be the grants manager for the Local Arts Council, at the risk of never working in this town again, because I'd be the one that, you know, gives those calls or emails, good or bad. I'm originally from Los Angeles, and I just knew that moving here, that any of us that work together, we would need to move beyond local funding. But it's also really forced us to look at working very closely with the communities that we hail from. So since Klee and Ryan are Diné, we actually did an entire field trip over about 4 days to Diné territory, to the coal mines, interview people, and their voices are part of they are informing our production. And then finding ways to create work that we felt was able to respect what we were hearing, but also to have a creative space. Did I answer the question?
Thank you all for going first. My name is Daniel Banks. I'm co-director of DNAWORKS with Adam McKinney, who's over there. We moved to Santa Fe in 2010 because Adam was offered to create the dance program at the New Mexico School for the Arts, which is a charter, a public-private collaboration arts school in Santa Fe that opened in 2010. And 2 years ago, I was asked to bring back the performing arts program at the Institute for American Indian Arts, which has been dormant for 20 years. The Institute is the only four-year Indigenous Arts College in the U.S. I'm a director. I'm a kinesthetic learner, and sitting down at a chair behind a table separated from everybody is extremely alienating for me. Also, I know there are a lot of performers in the room. If time allowed, I would get us all up on our feet singing and do a giant story circle, because that would actually be my art form, is to facilitate community voices rising together. But since we have limited time, I've concocted a shorter version of that. I'm assuming everybody needs a seventh inning stretch, so let's stand up. And take a stretch. Separate those ribs. Feel all your ribs. Just, yeah, up on your toes. Up. Reach up. And now as you start to come down, see if you can connect to the person next to you physically in some way. Find some physical way that everybody in this room can connect. Peta, oh, so wait, the panelists over there, you need to, oh, no, you need to connect with the rest of the community. Okay, is everyone connected? And so, and now actually everyone is connected to the mic, symbolically. Yeah. So, great, thank you. That to me represents, and I hope you won't mind if I stand, but I think better when I'm standing. That represents to me both our aesthetics and how we overcome the challenges in New Mexico. Is anyone else here from New Mexico? I know Colleen's worked and lived in New Mexico. Anyone else here? Okay, great. So I don't want to speak for New Mexico, because that would be silly, having only been there 6 years, but I can share some of our experience there. There's only one equity company in New Mexico, and that's in Albuquerque. It is impossible as a theater actor to actually earn any kind of a wage in New Mexico. You can combine that with film, but for instance, in Santa Fe, there's little to no paid theater in Santa Fe. And I won't go into, I mean, I'm sure we'll have Q&A and if folks want to know more about that, but I just want to put that out there. You actually can't be a professional theater actor in New Mexico, only doing theater, number one. Number two, as most folks know, New Mexico is unfortunately really far down, like 49th and 50th in terms of welfare for young people in the country and poverty in the country, and it keeps vacillating between 49th and 50th position. Tragically underfunded, really, I mean, more than 50% of the people, when I say I live in New Mexico, they say, oh, you live in Mexico? How's that? How'd you get to Mexico? I was like, no, I actually live in the United States, called New Mexico. And I would say about 60% of the people hear Arizona when I say New Mexico. So then they're like, oh, Phoenix? No, New Mexico. And I say that, I mean, it's funny, but it's not funny, because it actually means that it's an area of the country that is very still not known to people, except Santa Fe, and people still think that's in Arizona. So it's challenging, and there is not enough arts funding in New Mexico to sustain professional theater companies. There are music and dance companies and opera companies that have figured it out, but as far as theater goes, or a kind of whether that be play-driven theater or ensemble-driven theater, probably the most successful is Theater Grotesco, which has does quite a lot of touring, actually more touring than performing in New Mexico, and has a 20-plus year history, so they figured out how to make it work. But even so, I'm not entirely sure that they have full-time company members. I think that there's, you know, people do many jobs and many things. So in terms of the aesthetic vocabulary, our aesthetics, there's in New Mexico, there's no difference between aesthetics and practice to me. They're really the same. DNAWORKS had an operating principle, which is that we don't go into anywhere that we're not invited. We don't look for an area that we want to work in and say, hey, would you, you know, or look for funding and go to someplace. It's really invitation driven. It's community stakeholder driven. So the projects that we've done in Santa Fe so far and in New Mexico have been requested and driven by community partners. And so that same thing that we just did here is exactly what we've done in New Mexico. In 6 years, we've partnered with over 25 different organizations across the state, many of whom who have never sat at the same table with each other. So we bring people together, and then we say, okay, so how do we find the resources to do this? And part of what that means is Adam and Colleen and I were just having this conversation earlier, is that Adam and me being people who embody multiple heritages, multiple cultures, multiple subject positions, academic speak, we serve as bridges between communities. And so we are able to bring people to tables who normally don't sit at tables together. And we're able to talk in the vocabulary of each of those communities in such a way that they find their common interest. And that is both the aesthetics and the practice. The work that we create also for that to happen in an audience context, not just in a pre-production, a production context or funding context, but actually what does it mean to have the sort of the theater-going audience, which again, I use the word theater very specifically because that sort of signifies a building and seats and tickets and orchestra, balcony, right, class distinctions. The audiences that are familiar with that kind of context, what does it mean for them to go to the south side of Santa Fe, which is mostly where the barrios are and where working class folks live, where there are affordable rents? And what does it mean for them to see a story by a play by Guillermo Mayorga that was workshopped at the O'Neill Festival, but is very much about a Chicano family in San Antonio, and have folks sitting side by side, and then have a community dialogue afterwards, which all of our pieces do, and have audience members say, "That's me on stage. I've never seen myself on the stage before," and then other audience members say, "I've learned more about my neighbors tonight than I have in 20 years ago." And having those conversations be witnessed by each other, so that kind of humility that I think performance can engender in the audience, having actual people who live in physically in geographic proximity to each other experience each other as humble, that does something to over, that changes the dynamic. And then I think also part of this, and this is why I asked Roberto if he wanted me to be on the panel or not, is because we are an LLC. When we formed, we wanted to get it done quick, so LegalShield, thank you very much, or LegalZoom, and we formed as an LLC, and Fresh Atlas became our fiscal sponsor. But then as we began to explore, did we want to actually convert that into a 501c3? We realized that we didn't, because we're small. We wanted to stay small. We wanted to actually, we were creating intellectual property, and we wanted that as a collective to be, as an ensemble, to be owned by the ensemble, not by us individually. And that poses problems if you have a 501c3 and a board decides they want to close you or something, as so many of our friends have had that experience. And so so then we learned about social entrepreneurship. I actually did a fellowship on social entrepreneurship. How do you have a way to generate revenue that then you can take that revenue and filter it into your so-called not-for-profit or arts practice. And that's been very successful. Again, doing what we just did here, but with a larger community of stakeholders, inviting people to be not financial stakeholders, but social stakeholders. So really leveraging that kind of social capital or social equity and having ambassadors. And, you know, these are all things that I've read about that symphony orchestras are doing and other organizations are doing. I've attended a couple theater communication groups events on audience engagement, audience revolution. So having ambassadors who we ask that they hold theater parties and have a dinner party before a performance and then bring 10 people with them to the show. Or having businesses, actually businesses are really hungry. We found that business owners are really hungry to be engaged as people. So we would go in and we wouldn't ask them for money. We would simply say, you know, we've developed relationships with business owners, and we go in and say, what are you working on? We'll talk about this piece. They say, oh, do you have a poster? And so we began to realize that we were providing a service to them, because then if they have a poster and postcards at the front, and it's usually like the owner of the business, because Santa Fe is very, you know, there still are some small businesses, that they'll say, what we'd like to tell our customers about it. Can you give us information? So we began actually bringing that out there and asking businesses to be ambassadors. And then this gives people an opportunity to interact with their customers on a social cultural level, not just on a monetary level. Everything that we've asked of people has been on leveraging so-called social capital, and that has then led to people offering financial capital. But we didn't start with the ask. We created on one of our last productions, Cascarones by Guillermo, we created a associate producer, community associate producer board. And all that we did, we asked seven people that we knew, or seven couples that we knew from various different cultural groups in Santa Fe, if they would A, lend their name to the poster so their name was above the title, and B, talk it up with their communities. And that's all that we asked for them. And we said, you know, if you want to come to the gala, if you want to bring folk friends to the gala, that's great, but we're literally, we led with, I'm not asking you for money. And it worked, and we oversold that theater. We sold more seats in that theater than have ever been sold before, just by asking people to be connectors of people in probably the most segregated city that I've ever lived in. And I see the nod back there, so okay, I'm not making this up. Reality check. So I can say more about that, but again, it was interesting. I was asked to write an artistic statement for an award, and I found as I was writing the artistic statement that I was also sort of talking in this very producerial way. But there's a point at which, when you live in certain places, the production of art, I mean the creating of the art and then the creating of the context in which the art is going to be received and viewed, to me there's no distinction between the two. It's about creating a kind of a cultural awakening or some kind of, I'll let someone else name it, but it really became clear to me as I was writing this statement that I was not going to get the award because they just wanted to hear like the aesthetics. And it's like, how can you evacuate the sociology and the politics from the aesthetics? They become one at some point.
I have a question for you guys, and then we'll open it up to you, all of you. But I like that last comment, because in some ways what I was talking about, the aesthetics belong, what you're creating is sort of a concept of the week, whether it's in relationship to the land or whatever, what may be the essence of the piece that you're working on. But I just sort of, started this story earlier, and I'll ask this in a form of questions for you, guys, but I was telling the story earlier working with Chris Dwyer, who I think is an advisor to you guys, on a project that was funded by Rockefeller Board about a decade ago, about looking at the support system for new work development. And there was I talked to a lot of artists, it was really great. And a couple of things that resonate for me is sort of the importance of having networks of trust, and especially as it comes to feedback loops on your process. So can you talk a little bit about that, about how do you have a network of trust and a feedback loop when you're not on the coast, and you're not, and you're in the desert, you're on the border, and you have these other sort of, yeah, how do you address that need?
For us, part of it is that the networks of trust also include the communities that we're working with. And part of it is that for us going actually to where different communities reside. And at one point, I mean, was like you're saying, indigenous land, and then Cleveland Valley, and our group said, this is all indigenous land. And I thought that was a good learning experience for me, but also a really interesting dialogue about how do we build this trust. We've had many discussions in our group about how we can change the model of how we create work so that it is also involving Native American practice in it as part of it, including prayer at the beginning and a real intent, and building the empathy between us for working and also just personal building the work. It is hard because we're in Tucson is kind of isolated in some ways. Segregated, definitely. We definitely create a lot of studio time. That's something that actually is lacking a lot in Tucson. There's not a lot of places to show and laboratories to just try new work. We're using today as a laboratory. It's, we've been asked, been invited. We said, yes, we will do it, regardless of where we are in our practice, because we wanted to create that dialogue. So you are part of our building of new work. And we do try to have a high bar, for a lack of a better term. We just decided this is important to us aesthetically. But in that process, working with community, we're finding ways to always have the community inform our work. We're not creating in a vacuum. And it is very much, the art is the making of it as well. And we take that very seriously, and that's why we're willing to go long term. But in that, regard. It also forced us to think, how can we sustain ourselves monetarily and also just in terms of energy? And so that's been a pacing process and a long-term process that instead of just like, oh, we can do this tomorrow, we'll be done, and we'll just, you know, we actually had to really think it through and have dialogue. When we go to, let's say, to the Navajo or Tohono O'odham areas and we talk to people, we just get some feedback on it. We interview people. Adam Bergeron is doing a lot of interviews and just to ask them what's been going on. And that is part of our project.
So I'll just talk briefly about the project I'm working on now, which is working with saguaro cacti. And the first thing I did was to give myself the task of standing with one for an hour. And it raised a lot of questions about performer and audience. If your audience is a cactus, you know, what's the feedback loop there? Or if you are the audience for a cactus, what's the feedback loop? So it raised a lot of interesting conundrums for me about, you know, who's performer, what does performer mean? Is that really a performance? Is there an audience? I say that kind of as a joke, but I mean, it really has made me think about that. And then so part of what this project will do is we'll invite others to the park to have that same kind of experience of 1 hour or whatever you can do, sitting or standing, you know, which then is like, is that dance? Yes. Is that theater? Yes. I mean, some people might say no, but it's a certain kind of performativity that's happening. But then sort of just the larger question about feedback loops, you know, there is no dance critic in Tucson. There are theater critics now, but you cannot get a review of work and of dance in the city of Tucson. And part of that is because most dance performances are, they're only 2 to 3 nights. They don't run for a long enough period of time. So it's been really challenging. I think it's been sort of, in some ways, a detriment to the dance community, but also then there's this question of like, well, you know, like the Liz Lerman question of who's the dance for, and you know, what are you measuring what's your gauge of measurement in terms of who it reaches and how. So I tend to go outside of the dance community for my feedback. There's a very strong literary community in Tucson, very strong visual art, very strong theater presence in Tucson, and I get some of my feedback in that sense. But I do think that question too of like who are we making the work for and what's the objective has a lot of weight in terms of what the work is and then how we review it or critique it or think about its success.
So there's one main newspaper in Santa Fe that mostly covers the touring productions at the big major house. We've gotten a lot of advance publicity, but I don't think we've received any reviews. There's now a new independent periodical that a woman named Frances Madison has put forward, and she's trying to cover all the performing arts that she can to sort of balance it out. So much in the same way that we were just speaking, we have created very different notions of what feedback looks like. Santa Fe is a very, very small town in some ways. In other ways, it's a series of ethnospheres that never interact. And so, but it, the small town notion is really, I will often joke, if you sneeze on one side of town, someone will hand you a handkerchief on the other side of town. But everybody knows what's happening with everybody there, which is sometimes good and sometimes not good. So our feedback loop is, do people come? You know, are we actually able to get people to the performances? Because that's a common complaint of a lot of the smaller independent community-based groups, is that they can't actually get audiences. So number one, do people actually come? Because word of mouth is really the primary source of information in Santa Fe. Number two, do the rooms look like this in terms of being a representation of all of the cross-section, the full cross-section of Santa Fe and its environs. And then also who hears about the piece? We will often, when we're working on something, and if someone meets us and say, oh, aren't you the guys from DNAWORKS? Or, oh, DNAWORKS, we've heard about you, aren't you doing the piece? And when people outside of our immediate spheres know about the work, that means to me that something's working within the community, because again, it's word of mouth driven. We have some trusted colleagues that we've built and grown with while we've been there, but I would say that for the most part, our practices and our sort of, I would say the ethos of our work is very different from a lot of the different groups there, and oftentimes our collaborators are in our pieces, so it's a little hard to have the outside, you know, the people that we're close with are usually involved in what we're doing. And those relationships are really driven by breaking bread together, eating together, meals, community meals. We have a table that's not quite this big, but almost this big, and we just try to fill it once a month with people, and that's just our way of building our creative community and our feedback community. And we talk at those tables about our work, about other people's work, about the work we're trying to do, about the struggles. So that's how we build our network of trust, is around the dinner table, and that's our feedback.
Before I open it up, I have a story to tell. My dad is from Tucson, but I grew up in the Bay Area. I've been in Tucson for about 10 years. But when my dad was alive, we'd come down every spring to see my dad, and we'd go to Yaki ceremony. And Old Pascua, those who know where that is, it's basically an enclave of Yaki community that the city has sort of surrounded. That's where they do the Easter Yaki dance ceremony. So I remember going that as a little kid and being totally like, these kids look like me. What are they? They're Indian. Oh, okay. You know, but more than anything else, the ceremony was like, you know, they go up and down the plaza there, and they tap, and they go back and forth, and I don't know. I didn't know what the hell it was, but I was mesmerized. And for me, that became the beginning of my love of theater. And I put that in the context to sort of, in a way, to talk about one more thing, and then I'm going to actually call upon some people in the audience to talk about this. One of the two things that I really appreciate about Tucson is a strong festival culture. Paul and Nadia have produced an event called the All Souls Procession, which is an annual procession through downtown Tucson, about 100,000 people who honor the dead. So it's a hybrid of sort of like Day of the Dead, anarchists, fire people, aerobatics, circle arts, and the dawn. I mean, it's all dead. I mean, everybody goes down and walks through town. And Maribel is one of the nation's best folklorists. She's in the back, and she produces a thing called Folk Life Film School, and Tucson Meet Yourself. But this notion that heritage practices are very active and alive and very robust, and part of why they operate as they do is that, I like to use the term, did I get this from you, Maribel? I don't know if I did or not. This notion of a contemporary traditions. That, and in some ways, the heritage of our desert, our indigenous voices, Latino voices, are still reimagined constantly in new forms. So that was my little, like, I wanted to call out, and anyway, I'll call you out. But I wanted to call out these experts in the house. So let me just, since I mentioned your name a lot, she's a dancer, she's got a solo performance piece she's been working on about being a performer and a parent. Also, she's worked with Borderlands and on various projects. So these are my colleagues that are in the house, so ask some questions later on about the scene I know too well. But let me open it up for questions from anybody. And remember, we're all connected. We've already... So don't be shy. Yes, sir.
Should theater companies have what businesses have, which is a strategic plan in order to really engage their communities? Because oftentimes, after people go to the audience and they watch that first show or that first performance, what's the next call to action? So what are we asking people to do beyond go to the theater to really establish a sense of community and really train these audiences to become full-time supporters of the arts? So what are some strategies?
Well, I have a thought, but I think Colleen probably has better insights. Because she's like a big time producer, presenter. One of the things though, but I will turn the microphone and I will talk. And because I'm so investment in engagement processes, I also, and I think I learned this from colleagues, maybe I learned this from Stephanie, maybe I learned it from you, I'm not sure. I learned it from somebody in the alternate roots world to understand the notion of being a guest and a host. And that when you really, as a presenter, you're always a guest. Initially, you start off as a guest. You know, I remember having to speak to Opera America people, and I said, you're a guest. And they go, no. I really know how to do host really well. I red carpet down, you know, I mean, I can really do this. I said, no, man, you're a host in the locale of your city. And then, that's where you start. And then you know how to be, I mean, excuse me, you're a guest of the hotel of your city. And then you know how to be a host. But just to sort of bear that in relationships that we're all, you know, guests on the planet, and then we become hosts eventually. So I didn't, Colleen, do you want to add anything?
You know, I would just say a couple of things. As far as I think that's a great question. And we often invite people into our spaces without saying anything before or after. And we often don't allow for the time to meet them even before they get to the spaces. And we've been very fortunate in this past year. We've been working on a wellness grant about sustaining audiences. And one of the things that we learned from that is we want to meet with you before you even come, before you even think about coming. So what we've been doing with our artists is saying, we're just going to have a party. We have like little afternoon get-togethers. Come, it's free, and you're going to get to talk to the artists and have a little drink and have a little food. And we're going to have a performance. And traditionally what we always thought is, we didn't have the Q&A. That's like the real meat of the thing. 9 times out of 10 people don't want the Q&A. They want to hang out. They want to say, what did you think about that? So now we like wiped out the Q&A and we say afterwards come right across the street and Pepecubo, which is just a bar across the street. We have the rooftop. We're going to have food and drink and just come and hang. And people like came from so many. I met a guy who said, I took 3 buses to get here so I could come and hang out. And that it really made a difference. And another person said, I don't even know what the next thing you're doing, but I like this so much that I'm going to come. So first of all, the approach doesn't happen once they're in the theater. It's way before they get there, but it continues way after they leave. Now I think the other thing is for us, we do this with our artists, and we do this with our community. We ask 3 questions. What do you want? What do I want? And what do we want together? And we have to do that with our communities and say, what do you want? Because it's not about what I want. I know what I want, but I have to know what you want. And then we work on that sweet spot of what we want together, and that's what moves us ahead and gets us to that next step. And you are so right, Marcelina, we cannot do this without thinking there's a next step.
Questions? Come on. Yes, Mark.
You talked about seeing as a young child coming to these ceremonies, and we've got this cactus performance, and you know what each of you are talking about. And there's something you talked about not having the theater critics and not having the theater infrastructure. It's something that Carlton talked about when we were in Raymond, was in Jackson. That culture happens in all these different places. And I actually wonder if you actually aren't leading us into something that we have yet to find, which is how we see, how we learn, how we create, not in a building, not in a theater building, but how we take culture, how we take art, how we make it a part of everyday life, which I think in these places that are not the coast, but in these places where there's an outdoor, this life that happens outdoors, that it feels like we have something to learn. There's no question there, but it's just an observation.
If I can speak briefly to that. One of our guest artists in our group, Alex Soto, who's a Tohono O'odham spoken word artist, one of our earlier sessions, we said, let's think about what the world would look like if settlers had never come, if we had never come. And he said, we were sitting at ASU in a room, you know, this beautiful studio with Marley and mirrors, and he says, you know, maybe we wouldn't, this would not be our university, maybe our place of learning would be outside under a tree. Our canals of our Hohoka ancestors would be the canals where we learn how to irrigate, and, you know, basically a very different way of thinking. Early on, when I first met Roberto at NAO, is that way back, we were at a big think tank of artists and presenters, and the Native American artist who was in the room came up to me quietly afterwards and asked me, why are you following basically this a white man's way? And I just thought it was such an interesting deconstruction of what we were doing, just taking it all back. So I think because of where we live, we have now an opportunity, because we have living with Celeste, to now just go forward and think, yeah, how can we work differently and use what we have, which is a closer community where you sneeze and someone says, gazoom type over there, you know, or something else. So that has become part of our living with less policy, I guess. It's just like, what do we have? Okay, let's just work with this. Whoever's in the room, that's important. That's what we do, and that's how we begin that dialogue.
Hi, this is more an observation. I've lived in Arizona for almost 10 years. I teach at the Herb River Institute for Design and the Arts in the School of Film, Dance, and Theater, and we bring a lot of young artists through our program, through U of A, NAU, all these various, or maybe not even in the programs, but there's a gap that's missing between, say, GAMMAGE and various, the Arizona Theater Company and other institutions, FOSTA Public Art, and then those who are just coming out, the young emerging artists. There's this big gap, even for the ACA. In ACA grant, you've already been sort of an established artist, you have to have work out there, so there seems like there's an incubator space to help younger artists get their footing, because all of them want to, as soon as they graduate, they all want to go to New York, Chicago, San Francisco, Minneapolis. It's like diaspora, they all want to get out of here as fast as they can. So I think the arts, those who fund the arts and work in the arts, need to think about how do you keep the young artists here, because they're the future of the arts in Arizona. If they're all leaving, how do you make this a vibrant, thriving community? Like you were saying, Santa Fe, you can't make a living wage as an actor in Santa Fe. You can't really make a living wage as an actor in Phoenix either, unless you work with Arizona Theater Company and maybe one other company, HowlRound. And all the shows that come through GAMMAGE are mostly coming from New York or other places. So that seems to be a place of focus that we need to think about. And as an educator, it's sort of turning students out into the Arizona landscape. You know, how do you
just
stay here?
Just a pitch for the second panel, but that's something that I'll be speaking about in the next panel.
And if I could just change hats for one second from DNAWORKS to IAIA, in creating this new curriculum, we created a curriculum with three pillars. One is performance, one is applied arts, and one is arts education. So to come through at the moment, we have a minor working towards a major, but to come through the program, you actually have to do training in all three, so that there is actually a way in New Mexico to make a living as an arts educator, just not as a performer, which is ironic, but at the same time, if applied theater means creating new work with youth or with youth and elders or with in tribal contexts, then that is actually a way to make a living as a theater artist. So we want to, you know, as I'm sure you know, Rachel, a lot of universities are introducing applied theater into their programs. Some colleges have even done away with their performance programs, and they are going only to applied theater now because they recognize that is the best way for young theater artists to make a living is taking arts into community and working in community contexts.
And I would just say, one of the great things having Stephen Tepper as the new dean at Herberger, Stephen and I have been working on a series of projects, which include a pipeline for our young people and our young artists to become teachers of the next generation coming through, and also to apply opportunities for those young artists and our student artists to work in our communities and to work on issues based in each of the communities that surround and serve us. And in addition to that, to work with practicing artists to come in and be community engagement artists and to teach that. And so I really feel like Herberger is actually leading the way in doing that. We're not only just partners in word, we're putting money into that project.
Let me sort of piggyback again. I had the pleasure of working with Mark two summers ago. He did a professional development workshop at the Arts Council, really looking at Latino and Latina playwrights and the support system for that work. And I recall, and you can add more, another layer to this story, the dean or the head of the theater department from the UA was there, and basically everybody was saying, "You're dead." I mean, you know, the rise of ensemble theaters, and we got some great examples, is really where it's at. You're training people for the Lorts, and they're not going to exist. And you better wake up, you know what I mean? And only because Octavio Solis was a playwright that was sort of like the anchor. And he's one of the few Latino playwrights that get onto the main stage in a Lort house. And so we just, it was in a way that the artist community was sort of giving the finger to the university. You're irrelevant, unfortunately.
Mark, want to add to that?
I the only thing I would add is that he really didn't have anything to say in response to that. And I think as far as how do we keep young talent here, I think we have to utilize the things that we have here that are not in New York or Chicago or LA or wherever people are going. And for us at Borderlands Theater, the environment, being able to work outside, having the weather, other than those 3 or 4 months of summer, the rest of the year, it's an incredible place to do work outdoors that allows you to use fire, right? All kinds of gigantic spectacle things that you can't do inside of a building, right? It also allows that space for people to come, bring their own chairs, bring their own food, and it becomes more festival. I mean, these are, and then again, yeah, heritage practices that are here, that are native to this area. All of that, we've been doing a lot of mass work and puppetry lately, and that has a very long history, and it is a people's art form. But it doesn't mean that it needs to lack professional, production values and training. Eli is a graduate of the Del Arte Academy in California. His physical theater and puppetry and mask making skills were very, very useful to us. But at the same time, did we use just random people off the street as well? Yeah. There's a lot of, what's great about certain types of art forms is you can have professionals creating it, making it, and then still plug in non-professionals into performance, and it all looks and very beautiful still. But I'm looking forward to continuing to work more with environment, outdoors, just, blowing people's minds. And that's as simple as that.
But the thing, blowing people's minds with the everyday and the ordinary also, because, I just spent all last week with Maribel, in a folklore intensive, and, she has this great way of talking about folklore as, hidden in plain view. And so, if you take the theater out of the theater and you it's this new way of seeing, but you're seeing what's there, you're seeing it, now as a spectacle. Awesome.
I think Carl took your hand.
I kind of just wanted to speak about the issue of keeping young artists here, being a young artist that is still here, who has not moved. I think that a really wonderful way to do that is to change the perception of theater and what is theater and what isn't. And I think that that starts even though people think, you know, and I kind of low-key agree, that universities are irrelevant. Because universities and establishments like this are training artists like me to do theater in theaters, to try to be on Broadway, to try to, you know, master the Shakespeare and master this and the all of those white playwrights. And I think that the reason that I chose to stay, and the reason that I think a lot of more younger people are trying to stay here, or trying to stay local, is genuinely engagement with the community. And those are the issues that keep me tied here, and specifically me because I'm Mexican and know that my roots are here, and the work that I want to do is here, and it's getting the youth involved with the work, with the community, with the problems that need solving, because we have these wonderful young minds that just think incredibly, and we're teaching them to pirouette, it makes no sense to me. So I think that what we need from the universities and from higher, bigger establishments with the money is to kind of invest their time and their money into creating your own work as a young artist. And not just work about yourself, but the work around you and the world that you live and where you come from. We have stories and they are important. And they are to you and your home space and your experience. And people around you relate to that. So I think that that's where it starts, at least for me and for other young people that I know, is that we need to start telling ourselves that we're important, that we have things to say, that we have things to share, and that we can help solve these problems in our communities.
Carlton,
Carlton.
And his children.
Yeah, I was gonna add, I think part of the challenge is that we all have to, especially those of us that don't live on the coast and are working in the in-between areas, we have to challenge the narrow, very narrowly painted definitions of what success looks like in this industry. And that the only way to success is to go this very particular route that leads you to a very particular destination. And so we have to figure out ways to not just validate, not just have that as a system of validation, but look at other ways that your work and your artistry, your purpose, your mission can be validated and not be seen as less than the other route. And I think that that's where we fail, is that we create these unsustainable visions of what success looks like. Because if everybody achieves that success, then the world will be destroyed in weeks. And we're seeing that. We're seeing everyone chasing this American vision of what the dream is, and it's leading us to our demise. And part of that is that our sector also, you know, is bearing the brunt of that, as everybody wants to be the star and the fame and want to make, you know, whatever figures or whatever. And ultimately, it's diminishing our capacity to be relevant and to save ourselves.
Yeah, I wanted to talk also as one of the young artists from Tucson, Eli or Taria. So like Mark said, I studied at Del Arte International and I did their program. So I was a young artist here in Tucson and then I left somewhere else to go get training. But I came back and I've been working with them. And I want to talk about just two specific instances in Tucson with young artists. I have the high school I went to, having the fifth high school, had an excellent theater program, and some of the seniors this year, some of my friends when I was a senior, they took it upon themselves to create their own theater company called Acting Innocent in Tucson to talk about the issues that were important to them that they weren't allowed to talk about in schools. Issues with bullying, with gay and lesbian stuff, with things they just couldn't talk about, with violence in schools that they weren't allowed to go, you know, into stuff in the classroom. And they created their own company, and they went out and they went to different spaces and they asked. They said, "Hey, we have the shows." You know, they emailed and they show up, and then you know they're 18, they're 17, and they show up to these venues, and they're like, "Hi, I'm so and so from so and so," and they're like, "Oh, you're so young. What are you doing?" Like, "Oh, well, we have our own company. We're gonna have our own stuff." So one way to is to speak to the issues that have. Sort of like nervous in front of all you guys who are like, my brain's going like this. But I guess my point is, like, they were in an environment at the high school where they were fostered to really have their own voice and go, "Hey, you can go do it. and to have a support system for those kids. Because, you know, I don't know how many of you in Tucson have heard of them. They've done one little show. They're real new. But they decided, hey, we're going to do it ourselves. We're talking about stuff we want to talk about. And then the other one I want to say is I'm volunteering at another high school on the south side, San Miguel High School. And they and we're doing an adaptation project with these kids. And it's the third year of their residency of having an arts program at all. So these are kids who, they're kids from the reservation, from Pascua, from the Mexican-American kids, who have never been exposed to arts before at all. And we're doing a project there that using Mexican-American folktales and stuff from their culture and really giving them the tools to speak again their voice, stuff that has meaning to them. And I just wanted to share those two experiences as kind of one of those young artists. Like, I don't know how, like I train, I do stuff with the community here in Tucson, but it's hard to stay. There's the pull to these bigger other places. You're like, oh, the coast, California is great. There's so many opportunities. And same with New York. Like, I'm a DeLarcian. I do clown. I do that kind of stuff. I'm way on the fringe. I don't want to be a big on Broadway and, on stage. But all my friends who are my age, that's what success means to them. That's what they're taught in schools. Like you said, the university trains actors to be in a theater that no longer exists or that shouldn't. So I don't have an answer, but I just wanted to.
Why do you stay
in Tucson? For me, where I grew up, it's my roots. The issues that I want to talk about, where I want to find my voice, are Mexican American issues, their border issues, or things where I need to say these things. I need to have my voice expressed, and that's here in Tucson. So I came back to find that to work with, because I had connections to the community already. Because as a younger student in high school, I got the opportunity to work with some university students to do other work in the community. And they welcomed me in, like Mark, uses kids from high school. Some of the kids in Borderlands were younger than me. They were 17, they were still in high school, and they loved the arts. They loved being able to do that kind of stuff, to be out there and have their voices heard. I felt like I had that opportunity in Tucson to do that.
Great. Let me give that gentleman over there with the blue shirt. I'm going to make a comment.
Thank you.
Thank you. One of the challenges that I told you a story about me coming back to Tucson. I actually think that one of the challenges as a presenter, as an intermediary, as a producer, is to really be engaged with the circulation of ideas. Not only you guys are coming here, great, we got to do some show and tell, but at the same time, I brought Aaron down to Tucson and like, you made them all swoon. And so, it's like, this is about the circulation, like, we do not want to be always isolated in our, even though everybody here, and especially in this panel, does get out and circulate, but I think there's that value that's really important to the work.
No, I just felt I needed to defend the universities and colleges. as being a presenter at a small liberal arts college in Connecticut, not certainly from this part of the United States, but there are so many different routes and paths for individuals to make their way into the theater. I'm not a faculty member, even though I do teach part-time for the theater department, and we would be fooling ourselves if we were to be telling our students that they're going to make it on Broadway. And we're practical. We train them in a broad range of things in the theater to be prepared for the theater today. And what is the theater today? And again, so many different styles, so many different pathways, so many different learning styles for each individual, that there are so many different ways to make your way. And we should have that full array. And I think our students do go out into the world with an understanding of their art form and how to make the most of what they have with other skills that they get from us. you know, working within the community, a variety of things that are available to them on campus. Now, there are some schools that I do agree, very limited. It's sort of the Broadway is the goal, but there are many others, and I think the majority, that are not. So, again, there's so many different pathways.
I was really struck by this idea of the building a culture of we, of the we. And it's funny that you said that. I just had a conversation with one of my mentors earlier, and she said, well, you know, what we have to move away from is the us and the them. But that is, I think if we're honest with ourselves, that's the hardest part of our work, because we all fall into that colonialism of the us and the them, whether it's the presenter and the artist or the artist and the presenter. It is the hardest thing to move past, because at some place, at some point, we always fall into that place. It's the hardest thing when it comes to collaborations. And I've spoken as a person who really believes in trying to build the we. I think that that's what I come into this space looking at as a goal, that as we move forward as the artist going into some other communities, how do I help cultivate that culture of the we? Because I feel like we're building something together. I never feel like, oh, it's the us and the presenter. I feel like because they have expressed interest in presenting us, then that's something we're building together. And I'm challenged by that from a capacity standpoint. It's one of the things that make it the most difficult thing to help cultivate.
Very well said.
Hi, everybody. I wanted to just reflect on that as well. You know, part of each new generation of art that is made is all about changing the way people think and constantly redefining eras of theater, and through, you know, presenters or whatever. I mean, my mom was a journalist, music journalist in the 70s, and she reviewed a lot of pieces back in the day, you know, and Playbill and all of that. And I remember, you know, for Colored Girls, you know, she reviewed that. I remember Timbuktu with Jeffrey Holder and her kid, and The Wiz with Stephanie Mills, who I met when I was 11 years old, you know, so I'm not so young anymore, you know. But at that time, that form came right off the back of, you know, Annie, Get Your Gun, and all of the kind of traditional ways that were on Broadway. And then here came this explosion of new art that people said would never make it. And so I think, you know, as creative people, and especially now, in this time of the 21st century, you know, there's enough going on in the world where we are now global citizens, and because of the world is a smaller place due to technology, we know a little bit more about a lot of things. And so I think that the world is ready for us to express ourselves and to make these changes and to be brave enough. Who would have ever thought that any, you know, 60-year-old would be find themselves sitting in Broadway paying, you know, $300 to hear some black and brown people rap for 3 hours in George Washington clothes? Do you know what I'm saying? Who would have ever dreamed that that would have happened? You know? So anything is possible. Anything is possible. And it's such an honor to be here, because learning about, you know, making use of the land that you're here, making the community work for you, and opening up people's minds to look at the space in the sense of the space. If you have, I mean, that's like how we do back home. You know, I'm Cherokee and African American, but, you know, that's how we are. You know, part of our culture back in Kentucky is, you know, you sit on the porch and you talk, and then after supper everybody comes out and brings an instrument and you sing until the sun goes down. That's what we use as our platform to communicate and share our stories with each other. That's the way you just make use of what you have, and not to really worry about, you know, big institutions trying to define this template that we have to fit into, because from things that I see, I think that even though that's a kind of comfort zone and easy fallback, I think every institution is open to change if you can try to figure out a way to have them understand the story that you're trying to tell. That's
right. Don't forget, on Broadway, Eclipse, a story about Nigerian women kidnapped and raped is a Broadway show. Right. So to make assumptions about any of our genres is killing our own landscape.
Yes, and actually what I was going to say fits into what you all are talking about, because as a playwright living in Tucson, I have really become aware of the stories that are told in the American theater, right? I moved to Tucson, I'm not from Tucson, and I was moved to tell the story of the banning of Mexican American studies in Tucson Unified School District. And it was kind of a crazy thing to move from Chicago to Tucson as a playwright, who wants to make it as a playwright, because I thought, well, I'm interested in this story, but who's going to want to do it, right? Borderlands at that time was interested in doing it, and it was awesome. And we moved here to do that. But in living here, I really think about how many, you know, stories about the Southwest, or even stories about Chicanos or Latinos, are part of the American theater. How many of those stories are actually represented in the American theater? And how important is it to me as a playwright to tell those stories right now? I'm fascinated with Tucson stories right now because they're lacking. I'm fascinated about stories about Latinos or Chicanos because they're lacking, and we are a presence in this nation, and we have to challenge the idea of what a theater story is, what a profitable theater story is. That is where it's at. Who's funding what stories, and why are those stories being funded? Why is it only this particular story that is a producible play? I was really surprised that when I wrote my play, one of the Tucson reviewers loved the play so much, who is not Latina, that she nominated it to the National Association of Critics Steinberg Award, and it was actually passed on past the first round. So that is telling me, you know what, we are broadening, but we have to keep doing the work. We have to keep doing the work, and us doing the work here in places like Tucson, New Mexico, Memphis, is what's going to make that difference. Somebody needs to be here and do that work. And we're training young people to work with us. You know, what was amazing about Vital Stories is from the beginning, we involved community members. From the beginning, we interviewed them, we got their oral histories. You know they were gonna come and bring all their families because their stories were part of the production. But that's not why we did it. We did it because we really wanted to be about the body and not about the people. And then another thing was that, you know, Mark was talking about the 35 community members, La Gente, one of the installations, those were all non-actors. They were community members of various ages, and we pushed them beyond their comfort zone, and they went to rehearsal, and they were in the play. So I think that is a way of creating a theater audience in a place where there isn't, or people that normally don't go to theater. You know, people are hungry. People want to participate. They just sometimes need to be nudged. Sometimes they just need to be invited. Sometimes, you know, you just have to kind of drag them because their cousin is doing it, and so they're coming along. But I think that's how you create a theater audience. And I would love for theater to exist throughout the country, about all the different communities in the country. And what was amazing to me is the play Mas, it's very Chicano-centric. was produced in Oakland at Laney College. So there you go, schools promoting other stories, you know, like the community college. And the kids in the play were not Chicanos. They were a beautifully diverse group of kids. And here they were passionate and committed to learning the ways of the Chicano. And the play is a difficult, it's a challenging play to learn and to study, even as a Latino, but they learned the ways of the, you know, of this reclaimed indigenous cosmology that I think broadened their horizons beyond anything else that they had experienced thus far. And that, I think, is the power of theater. And that is, I think, why we do what we do. And that's why we're in this room here, because we are genuinely interested in that. And I think we just have to keep doing the work.
Nadia, who's sort of changing the chat rooms, but is, what can you just, you had a question. Can you tell a little bit about your, what you do?
Sure. I'm Nadia. My troops are Function and the All Souls Procession. This is what a beautiful conversation. Let me just say, yeah, like what a cool, yeah, like inspiring, yeah, like it got real juicy in here for, yeah, maybe it stays that way. So it's nice. And I wanted to shout out to you, like the Barrio Stories project was beautiful, really inspiring, really great work. And I wanted to say that, yeah, so what my experience has been, I grew up in New York, I grew up in New York City, where arts is very valued, but it's only valued if you're of a certain population. So it's very, it's elitist. It's very elitist, it's very exclusive, and I never felt that way growing up, being weird, arty, barty, freakish. I was like, I am an artist. Like it, you know, you kind of wake up and you're like, ah, I was born this way, right? So you just are that thing and you're driven to create. And I could have stayed in that environment, but I traveled all over the country kind of looking for where I fit and what my special purpose, and looking for what I was gonna do. And landing in Tucson periodically along my travels back and forth across the country. And I think in that pursuit, that place where we really start, as artists, it's our job to redefine what is value, what is cultural currency, like not just the coin of the realm, but what really matters to us, what is our coin, what is our value, like we, and from each one of our cultures and our unique voices and perspectives, we all have such beautiful different ways of weighing that currency and that that value, and I think that that is such a wonderful direction to look in, and I think that that's our job as artists, is to hold that vision, to be able to look through the things that people may have forgotten or they don't value, and to see the incredible, beautiful, inherent value in those things. And so, yeah, being in Tucson, I definitely, it's been a really big struggle. I mean, we do circus, which I always thought was a really not a viable kind of a profession. But apparently juggling is the one thing that everybody needs to know how to do. Like beyond multitasking, everyone needs to know how to juggle. And that's actually how we've survived. I mean, like everything in the kitchen sink, like we make equipment and we teach kids and we do summer camp. And like, if there was a way to like make, yeah, like you just hustle. Like if there was a way to make a buck, we would just venture down that path. And a lot of them, we were like, wow, we're just doing a lot of things really badly because we're doing too many things, we're spread too thin. And thankfully, over the past 15 years or so, many of those things have come to fruition. And instead of being these tiny little plants that we were just like, oh my God, I don't have water for all of you little plants, like one of you's gonna drop dead, it's gonna be really sad. Just rationing out the water and rationing out the energy, you know, to be able to feed all these things. Now they've all started to grow and they're pretty healthy and they're pretty happy. And I feel like being in Tucson and vibing on the special things about Tucson that are that very, the resilience of the desert, that really DIY, that really like, coming out of New York, like where you can't, there's a lot of regulations and there's a lot of things you can't do. Coming to Tucson and being like, wow, there is absolutely nothing you couldn't do because no one cares. Right? You're like, oh, I could do this. I mean, yeah, maybe I can support myself, but certainly you can do it. Which is an incredible value, right? Which is an amazing thing. And also that sense of success, like, what is success for us as artists? Like, is it to accomplish the work, or is it to necessarily get, you know, lots of accolades or, that's not how you say that word, but, you know, money and symbols of success for the work. Anyway, I'm rambling, but.
Great.
Yeah. There were just so many amazing things that everybody said all over the place, so I just wanted to say something too. Yeah.
Any last questions? I feel like we're kind of coming to a break moment.
I just want to add a couple of things. First of all, as a two-time university graduate, I will say that the university does work because it's through that training that I'm then able to go into the communities and actually instruct students, non-actors, how to position themselves, how to articulate, how to think creatively, all that. So I will say that the university does work. That's the first thing I want to say. Secondly, I'm a really big fan of what Borderlands is doing, and I'll say it for, and I'm going to connect it to the big picture. Mass works because it's a reflection of what's going on in the community. So I think once, as artists, we are honest with ourselves and we are honestly reflecting what is taking place in that community, there's an already built-in audience that will go and support you. I think the audience in some ways begins to ignore us or turn their corner when we are self-promoting on stage. So whether it be a playwright, whether it be a performer, whether it be an artist, whenever we are self-promoting, artists can understand the difference because they're smart enough, so they turn away. Whenever we understand those issues, which is really cool that that's the first conversation today, what are the issues here to Arizona, to the Southwest, it's education, it's poverty, it's displacement, it's indigenous. Once we put those issues on stage, then the audience goes. And then lastly, those big houses that do bring in those Broadway shows and those hits, I have to say, it's okay. I have to say it's okay. Because those folks that are writing, that are spending $300 a ticket, those production companies are then able to allocate some funds to then support local artists who are actually addressing the issues of our particular community. So I think once we understand this very complicated circle, but I think once we find where in that circle we are in, then we're able to go to the next step. That's all I wanted to add.
I didn't mean to damn the universities. I just thought that I was stuck. This will be the last comment.
Where are those funds allocated?
I'm sorry. I think if we write enough grants, I think if we do what Daniel said earlier, where we go out into the communities and when we become teaching artists, there's Title I funds, there's various arts grants throughout the country. You've got the Commission on the Arts that's going to talk in the next panel about the various grants. So I think if we knock enough, I think we can shake enough trees and get enough doors open. That's one artist perspective.
If I could just say one thing before I'll bring you the mic. I travel across the country and do workshops and meet with a lot of college students, and I meet more who say that they want to use the arts to change society than to say, I want to be on Broadway or I want to be in film. And some of these are actually at the major conservatories where they're being trained to be on Broadway and in film. And so, from my perspective, I mean, I haven't been to every single program across the country, but I get around. I don't think the programs are listening to their students, because most of these students are in programs that don't offer any applied arts work, who don't offer any arts education work. And so I think also in terms of our ability to be advocates and to leverage our local colleges and universities is to encourage them to provide these parallel track trainings. Because it does take training, you don't just wing it. You know, there's questions of ethics, there's questions of how to enter a community, be good guests, and leave a community. These are methodological questions, but I do firmly believe, and I put this in print, that this is the future of U.S. theater, is a better balance of what theater training looks like, and actually creating theater training that is equitable for all participants and not just the privileges of participants.
So I just have one comment. I'm hearing that we need to create this work. I'm hearing moving away from these colonial ideas of us versus them, thinking about we and new paradigm. And I'm also hearing that there's no funding. And I'm going to disagree with my friend over there who said that maybe if we could just writing, keep writing, and eventually we'll get funding. I want to challenge us, everybody in the room and beyond, to think about new ways and new paradigms to support each other and to support this work. Because I just don't know, right? I mean, Arizona, New Mexico, this is a very underserved region. I just don't know how can we move forward? How can we support each other that isn't competing against each other? Like, I work for Borderlands, but I'm also have my own dance company, so then there's a point in time when we're all writing for the same grants. So beyond that grant funding, how is it an LLC? I don't know. I don't have the answer, but how can we support each other? How can we continue to create these networks and do this very necessary work? So that's my big question. Thanks.
That probably is a good segue for the next panel. We'll take a break and we'll convene.